and a vision of the future.
Ago, it all looked so different. After long years fighting for their country, our boys were coming home. It went without question that their country now owed them something in return.
You'd better hurry. They're coming back.
Who's coming back?
The men and women, the boys and girls, the people who've been fighting this war for you. They're coming back. What have you got to show them? What?
Every film from those days reinforced the message.
What will it be like to be home again? Wondering about our own beds.
Hope my missus got memoir.
I bet she did.
Well, I bet you she'll have supper on the table and a couple of flowers. And...
bet she doesn't live in a place like that.
This is the story of what happened over the next 50 years, as the comradeship of war gave way to the conflicting ambitions of peace. No one talked much about the cost in those days. The optimism of victory convinced them that they could put to rest that old Britain, in which a few had so much and the rest had so little. The coalition government had done its job. As an election approached, both parties promised the nation a brighter tomorrow. Labour promised a revolution.
We of the Labour Party say that if this is the best that can be done under the present system, then the present system must go, and another one be substituted.
On July the 5th, 1945, the country went to the polls. To the astonishment of most pundits, they threw out Churchill, the man who'd won the war, and voted instead for Attlee, the man who had a blueprint for their dreams.
I remember when the election result was due to be announced, that I was working in a field with women and elderly men. But during the course of the day, every time the lorry came down, people said, "Have you heard?" And towards the end of the day, a man came, I could see him on his bike, bicycling over those tracks. And as he rushed into the field, he threw the bike on one side, raised his hands above his head and shouted, "They're in, they're in." And everybody in the field cheered. And there was a tremendous feeling of exhilaration that a Labour victory meant a new world.
Evening, accepted His Majesty's commission.
The clouds had lifted, and that we're going to have a government that really cared, and that we're going to do something about the squalor in the conditions that we've been living under for, over 100 years.
The Labour Party's plan, drawn up by a civil servant called William Beveridge, was to engineer a new society. The reality of a country on the edge of bankruptcy was not allowed to intrude on the dream. The state should provide for the people's education and look after their health. It should care for the needy and ensure work for the fit. But all that was pointless unless each family in this model society could be rescued from their cramped slums and given a proper place in which to live. The man Attlee put in charge was his fiery health minister, Nye Bevan.
The first need at the present time is to build houses for poor people. And therefore, houses had to be built to rent and not to sell. Because it doesn't seem to have dawned upon some people in this country that the vast majority of us can't afford to buy a house.
Nazi bombs and rockets had left thousands of city dwellers homeless. The limited council housing that had been available before the war was quite inadequate. One of the thousands of veterans to find himself homeless was George Day. He and his wife Joan roamed the street looking for anywhere habitable to live.
There were all houses running off the main street, so there you've got like two houses at the front and two houses at the back. So we went down the entry and got into this room where the little old, it was a little old man, because years ago they seemed to be old. And he came up and he'd black suit on, snuff all down the front of his waistcoat and everything. And he said, well, he said, I've got an attic. He said, it hasn't been lived in for years. He said, if you'd like to go up and have a look at it. So we went up the two flights of stairs.
It was just bare. One corner was open, where the roof had come away. And we had to put a tarpaulin up there, just for when it rained.
Well, you could see the stars at the corner where the bombing, I should imagine. And we just had to take it. And we were there for quite a while, weren't we?
2 years.
2 years.
Habitable in those days in those little houses didn't mean much. Many had no running water, no electricity, no sanitation.
The stove was in the living room. We had no bathroom, we had to go to the public baths, which we did once a week and queue up and have a bath.
These toilets haven't got any modern flush or anything of that kind. All the dirty water from the houses flows into a dip arrangement, and when it's full, it tips over and flushes them every so often.
No matter what the weather was, no matter what cold, freezing, snow, rain, whatever, you had to walk to the toilet. Toilet roll under one hand and a key in the other to undo that.
A pretty long run for anybody who needs to go to the toilet in a hurry.
From the beginning, there was something slightly surreal about Bevan's vision of the New Jerusalem.
We must introduce in our modern villages and towns what was always the lovely feature of English and Welsh villages. Where the doctor, the grocer, the butcher, and the farm labourer all lived in the same street. I believe that it is essential for the full life of the citizen to see the living tapestry of a mixed community.
The buzzword in post-war Britain was planning. There were plans for everything.
...9,500 people will live there.
There is a plan for the whole city.
We've got to fix our town centre.
Most of Manchester will have to be rebuilt.
One bedroom flats for young people.
Two-thirds of the people will have to move elsewhere.
We've churches, some bungalows for old people, and pubs.
It's a pretty gigantic scheme. But big problems call for big solutions.
We want you to think about this plan.
Brimming with good intentions, the planners wanted to fashion not only buildings, but the sort of people who lived in them. The prize part of their scheme was to take people from the war-damaged, vermin-ridden cities and place them in new towns, in greenfield sites miles outside the big metropolitan areas. One of the first was Harlow in Essex.
On my doorstep, here in Harlow, they began to build a new town, a place where there'd be houses with gardens for anybody who came and worked here from London, to give them an opportunity of life away from slums in a new garden city. And that was very exciting.
Dedicated men saw at last their dreams becoming fact. And work began.
By the late 40s, both the building work and the social engineering were underway. Frederick Gibbard, Harlow's architect, shared Bevan's vision of mixed villages, class peace instead of class war.
The designer's got to get away from the drawing board. He's got to get on the building site and get the feel of it.
An area of any size has to be developed as a mixed one.
Frederick had lived in a terrace in North London, which was mixed occupation. Some of the houses were owner-occupied, some of them by one by a cabinet minister, other by two by architects and other people of prosperous income, and also by some working class people who were tenants. And that mixed development had worked so well because people looked after each other. They were interdependent in a very sophisticated way.
Geographically, there was a mix that the skilled man or semi-skilled person would be living in close proximity to his or her manager. I think it worked initially. I think this was part of the new town community spirit, to some extent forget class differences.
Being as we're down here for the benefit of our children, when they grow up, they'll have mixed, they'll have already mixed. This is a new thing to the parents, but it won't be a new thing to the children because they'll all see each other's point of view.
But that didn't mean it was egalitarian. All applicants to live in a new town were carefully selected. Those without jobs need not apply.
As a matter of policy, we went to see the people we were trying to house, partly to make sure we built the right sort of houses, partly to make sure that they were the right sort of people. We were only allowed to contract to build a house where there was a reasonably well-paid, secure job to go with it. We had to get the industrialists first, we then had to build the houses, which meant, of course, that everybody travelled to work for months or even a year. But thereafter, there they were, living so close to their job they could come home to lunch, which infuriated the wives. They thought it was a very bad idea.
The local housewives, rid forever of the bogey of suburban travel, expect the whole family to be home at midday.
The first chairman of the new town's committee was the BBC's Lord Reith. His reporters now took the message to the people.
What sort of conditions were you living in before?
Well, we didn't have much freedom in the house. You see, there were other tenants and the same as everywhere else. You couldn't get on.
Overcrowded? Overcrowded?
Yes.
But you're not now?
No, plenty of room there.
Everybody should cut their front lawn once a week. One should not place motor cars on the front lawn and keep the place looking generally tidy. And as one went round, collected the rent, or anybody hadn't cut their grass would get a reminder that you're letting the side down.
Within 10 years, there would be 500,000 respectable people living in 16 new towns across Britain. New town living became part of the nation's promotional image.
I think there were many that were attracted by this utopian idea of the New Towns movement. I think once people came and settled, they had this great social optimism that we're doing the right thing and we're seeing here the future, that people are going to have a green and pleasant land.
But there was still a long way to go. Most cities were still choked with slums. Row after row of back-to-back houses falling ever further into disrepair. In parallel with building new towns, the plan was to sweep the slums away and replace them with proud new city centres.
What we'd got was the power to take over these vast areas of land, over 30,000 back-to-back houses, with the pubs, the churches, the cinemas, everything. So we could put a notice in the paper to say, this belongs to us. It was a piece of unadulterated communism. We took the lot over, everything.
In those days, Frank Price was one of a new breed of local politicians for whom clearing the slums was a crusade.
Alderman Price, you're chairman of the Public Works Committee, responsible for redevelopment in the city.
Yes, that's right.
He was taken by a BBC reporter onto a hillside above Birmingham to survey his new domain.
Now, over here you can see some of the type of property in which I was born. It is my ambition that no one ever will be brought up in houses like this ever again.
Hell of a promise. I said that we will have grass growing here and trees growing here that hasn't grown here for over 100 years. Where I'm standing now, this lamppost here, there will be a tree growing here. And it was one of the promises I was able to keep because I insisted on, when the plans came out, when we started the redevelopment, to having the architect move each plan just a little in order that I could plant my rowan tree where the lamppost was, and there it stands today.
There was no way of doing up bits of it. The concept that the councillors had had was to clear the whole redevelopment area out and start again. You know, new roads, new sewers, all the pubs, new pubs, houses, hospitals, everything like that. The whole area was clear. The whole area was cleared. That was the plan.
Just as with the new towns, the vision was infectious. The Birmingham city architect planning the shiny new estates was Shepherd Fiddler.
Shepherd Fiddler, as city architect, you're responsible for this.
Yes, I am.
What are you trying to achieve in the redevelopment areas?
Well, fundamentally, we're trying to create a community here where people will feel happy and at home.
Happiness was part of the plan.
Hello, Mrs. Bolger, have things?
And the planners thought they knew best what would make the people happy. And they were told, not asked.
We tried to warn them the previous year that their houses are due for demolition, and then we do our very best to find them accommodation that will be suitable, where they will be happy.
By now, the vetting procedures had been formalised. Housing visitors came round with a checklist of good housekeeping qualifications to keep unsuitable people out.
The visitors were very good living people, and they were the sort of people, the men were scout masters, and quite a number church-going, one or two Salvationists. And we were a wonderful group of people. We were very, very chummy. And I think that probably we did feel it was a calling. It was a crusade, you see. The chief welfare officer was a small woman with a lot of force. And although we didn't wear uniforms, we had to wear very plain clothes. No bits of fur, said Miss Smith. Because, of course, the vermin, you see, fleas, bugs. Two of our visitors used to have fleas and flea bites round the tops of their legs. So they puffed flea powder round the tops of their stockings to deter the fleas, you see. But I was never bothered.
I told them that the street was going to be demolished during that year, but I said, a housing visitor will come and see you from the local authority and see what type of a house and a home you keep. Some of you, and I have to tell it to you, a packet of flash wouldn't be amiss.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning. Not only did they spruce up themselves and their children, but their homes. One visitor said she saw the same carpet in about six houses. They would surreptitiously move it to another house.
Gradually, people began moving into their new homes. Good housing was becoming a touchstone of the welfare state's ability to deliver what people wanted.
There was a kitchen, a dining room, then the hall, then a front room, three bedrooms, bathroom and toilet. And you can imagine coming from one attic into a place like that. It was just...
A castle.
It was a castle, yes. It was.
We have already reached the figure of 750,000 new houses that was the coalition's first target.
But demand outstripped supply. In theory, city overspill should have been moved into new towns. But there was neither the space nor the time to build them. So architects came up with another idea to please the politicians.
The government completely ignored our requirements for new towns. So we had this problem of what do we do to provide houses for the homeless and houses for those to replace the slums. And we got into the high-rise development.
We must build upwards.
In the political numbers game, they yielded dividends quickly. Tenants reluctant to accept high-rise life were given a stark choice: stay in the slums or accept a flat.
Must
people say, well, aren't they frightful or something like that? You know, an Englishman usually says that sort of thing to start with, but after a while they get to like it.
And they were built with pride.
If you go down in Dyson Nedgels, you'll see four blocks, brick blocks, tower blocks, but delightfully done. They look good even now.
Those first high-rise blocks were designed to last. Steel-framed, brick-built, and with five fire escapes each. By the time they were finished in 1951, it was a Conservative Minister of Housing, Harold Macmillan, who came to open them. The Conservatives had begun by opposing much of Labour's welfare state. Not any longer. They saw voter potential every time a new block opened. Indeed, it was hardly a party issue.
We didn't have any flags flying saying vote for Dorish or anything like that. All the people would be told that it was going to be an official opening, so the people that lived in the block would be coming. The Lord Mayor would be coming in his car and with the coat of arms on the top. And the Chief Constable would be coming along to protect the Lord Mayor in another car. And you were following in a reasonable kind of a car as well. And then there would be all plants put outside the microphone where he was going to speak. It was a sense of occasion. The builders thought it was a sense of occasion.
For the builders, the 50s were boom years. With the political wind behind them, few expenses were spared in council house construction.
For a man in the print trade like Henry Edwards, a rent of 45 shillings and ninepence a week is dear. But he thinks the luxuries of central heating, constant hot water, and modern design make his home worth it.
Through the new towns and the new flats, the planner's original dream of a model society was beginning to take shape.
The double glazed windows swing over for easy cleaning. The kitchen of this flat has gas for the fridge and the cooker.
Council housing was good news, and that was official. Council landlords expected their tenants to keep the estates in good order. They appointed caretakers, often ex-military men, to ensure that everyone stuck to the rules.
You were issued with a uniform. You usually got a jacket, a couple of pair of trousers, a police whistle, which goodness knows why you had a police whistle, a polo neck pullover and a cap. And I think I've yet to meet any caretaker that wore the cap. It looks so stupid.
Mr. Wallace, you've been caretaker here for 3.5 years.
Yes.
The city has done its best to make it pleasant here. Do you think people are going to appreciate it and look after it?
Oh, definitely, yes. I do.
Thank you, Mr. Wallace.
Thank you.
You used to clean the communal areas, the lifts, the staircases, has to be swept and mopped and generally keep the place clean. You were mixing with very genuine people, and because they'd moved into there probably from back houses and slum houses, they looked after the property very well, and it was a pleasure to be there. I really loved my job.
Regular visits from the rent collector and the housing visitor were accepted as part of the new order.
They accepted, as they were council tenants, that, as one person always said, it's that woman from the estates. You used to see the curtains twitch, you see, and they were looking out. And they knew, they expected you. They expected you to go and to look around the house, to even inspect the beds.
But the dark side of the story was beginning to show through. The majority of poorer people were still untouched by the frenzy of building politicians were so proud of. By the end of the 50s, over 3 million families still lived without bathrooms. 2 million shared outside toilets. Many had no internal running water. The contrast between image and reality was something no amount of public relations could disguise.
We know now that we have built
more than 300,000 houses, new houses.
Politicians wanted a quick-fire solution. What they chose, without ever asking their tenants, ensured that the planners' utopian dream would never be realised. It was 1963, and in control of Birmingham City Hall was the autocratic council leader, Harry Wotton. He wanted a dramatic acceleration of the building programme and told the committee that a local builder, Bryant's, had the answer. System-built tower blocks. A few had already been put up in different parts of the country. They were cheap, fast to erect, but definitely not up to the standards so far established for council housing. Before he died, city architect Shepherd Fidler, who played such a crucial role in the early designs, gave this account of how Birmingham came to place its first order with Bryant's.
Chris Bryant said to Harry, "We'll take the committee to see a block at Kidderminster." We went in a bus to the site. In front of the block was this great marquee. The marquee was rolling in whiskey, brandy, food and so on, so we stayed there quite a long time. And then we went and looked at the flats. Well, by this time, they could have been inlaid with gold. They thought it was marvellous. They wanted to change over the whole programme. So we went round, and at the end, we went into the marquee again and had some more drinks. As we were leaving, Harry Wotton suddenly said, "Right, we'll take five blocks," just as if he was buying a bag of sweets. "Stick 'em on X," some sight he'd remembered. Well, I can tell you, I almost walked out on the spot. After leaving Kidderminster, the coach called at various hostelries on the way to the Civic Centre. What a day.
There was a close relationship between the councillors and the builders, for good reasons, and that is we just had to build properties. We had to build houses and flats. And I think the city council's view is we find the most efficient builders and tell them to get on with it.
Get on with it, they did. Within 5 years, Bryant's won over £25 million worth of house building contracts from Birmingham Council. After 10 years, a city architect and a Bryant's director ended up in jail for corruption. System building became the prescription for boosting housing provision all over the country. Standards progressively slipped, and the doubters kept their mouths shut.
Politicians and the councillors, let's build. You know, maximise everything. You wouldn't have got very far if you'd have been a housing director and you'd gone along to the leader of the council and said, "Well, we want to stop building these multi-storey blocks. They're not right, or flats at all. You know, you'd been looking for another job next week."
That's quicker. Homes from the factory. Why not?
What you could see was these great big cranes bringing different petitions up for the blocks of flats. There was in Mikado sets, you know, what children play with, and they was put up actually in sections, and we watched all that taking place. Terrifying, really.
There can be no argument whatever about the success of the Conservative government in dealing with housing. They've succeeded where the Socialists failed.
The Tories had now been in power for 13 years. They had presided over the consolidation of the welfare state their opponents had created. By 1964, promises of more and better housing weren't enough to revive flagging enthusiasm for its policies. Labour returned to power with Harold Wilson at the helm. But Bevan's Arcadian idyll had been replaced by a future to be forged in the white heat of technology. The new housing minister, Richard Crossman, was one of its standard bearers.
But factory-built houses can be just as good as production line cars. And once you get the thing going, of course, at the factory built, you come off jolly fast.
So the system-built blocks continued to rise all over the country. Ever more space had to be found. The slum clearance program advanced relentlessly. But instead of creating a model society, it was creating a succession of problems.
Nairn Bevan's vision was of building mixed villages of high quality housing where the doctor and the local employer and the baker and the tenant and the farm labourer would all live together in a harmonious community, and little enclaves created that vision. But certainly in the big cities where the house building was driven by slum clearance, it was never even attempted. It was a minimalist programme. It was housing packed together, and it was people shoved around with no choice and very few rights.
They sit at a desk or a drawing board. It's just a square piece of paper with a drawing on. That's a field, that's a house, that's a shop. Not too many shops, because we want them to walk a bit. That's how they see it.
One of the problems was that many people were reluctant to move to the sort of home the council were now providing.
That's why my husband and I are quite happy where we are. In spite of
old residents often preferred ground-level squalor to high-rise anonymity.
Is that a new stove?
Yeah, it's been in about 2 or 3 months, love.
That might hold a sideboard.
I had to tell people, you've got to leave here. You know, there wasn't any. Did you say, was it voluntary? Well, it wasn't voluntary. It was a case, you've got to go.
The chap sat down and he really cried and said, well, he said, there goes my castle.
Worse still were the problems slum clearance created for the people who had no legal right to be rehoused. Most people who lived in blighted areas were tenants of private landlords, there because rent was cheap. Some could join council waiting lists when the bulldozers came in, but recent arrivals were usually disqualified. Immigrants often fell into this category, and for them, finding somewhere else to live was doubly difficult.
We couldn't get any place. Some of them said that they only deal with, English and that. They wouldn't have coloured people.
The area that we lived in Holloway, was actually declared a redevelopment area in 1968, shortly after we moved there. And so we were actually caught up in the process ourselves. And of the 1,000 families in the area, 500 were made ineligible for rehousing. Almost all of them were black. And the landlords were actually advised by the council to evict them. And I was very, very shocked by that. Local authorities saw it as their job to house the traditional British working class. And they didn't see it as their job to house newcomers. They didn't think they had the resources to do it. And they weren't asked to do it. Nobody insisted that they should.
The truth was that some of those in most need of the Dream Society found that the rules excluded them. 21 years after Bevan had launched his crusade, a television play pricked the nation's conscience.
Mrs. Ward, I have to draw your attention to a fact which is not very pleasant, but in our emergency accommodation, well, it's not very nice. Some of the people are a little rough. Now, are you sure you want to go in?
Look, I don't want to be cheeky, but we've already been here for 6 hours. If I had any choice, do you think I'd have stayed?
Well, I don't think very much of it.
Mr. Ward, in many places in England, the families are not kept together. They're broken up as soon as they become homeless and the children are put in care, etc. Now, if we rehoused homeless families, people would say it was an easy way to jump the queue, wouldn't they?
By mischance and mismanagement, the great dream had not eliminated homelessness, but helped create it. The dream was visibly slipping away. The outcry which greeted the film put new building in the spotlight. Only speed mattered now.
New and quick methods have been used to overtake the backlog, with the result that a 13-story building was put up in only 18 weeks. The all-round convenience of Hornchurch Court should make a lot of tenants happy and satisfied.
But the factory-built Jerusalem was heading for disaster.
In East London, 3 people are dead, 7 are injured and 7 unaccounted for after the collapse of a 22-storey block of flats. Rescue operations have been suspended because of falling wreckage. American casualties in Vietnam...
It took some time for the implications of the tragedy of Ronan Point to sink in.
Now, what I have done is to assemble a team of experts.
The expert's report exposed a long list of corners cut and standards corrupted.
In terms of the sort of crucially important bits, like where one panel's meeting another and you've got bolts that are meant to hold those panels in position, what proportion of bolts were missing?
I would say about 80% were missing and about 20% put in.
Ronan Point was just the tip of the iceberg.
I watched the high-rise blocks being built, which were right by where I live, the Centre 8. The blocks were of very poor construction. On the flat above, they can hear every footprint across the floor. They can hear every noise that they're making. The facings, big, huge panels. And they were quite heavy because when one of them actually fell off, it was weighed by the city and it weighed 1.5 tons and it fell from the 6th floor. Luckily, nobody was underneath it.
A survey in Birmingham found 3,500 of these panels missing half their bolts. 83 were held in place by their weight alone. Council stopped further high-rise system building, but there was little they could do about the blocks already occupied.
Number one was the condensation, and that was where all the walls was dripping. Number two, the heating, which was underfloor heating, which was very expensive to run and was breaking down all the while. In the winter, your windows used to ice up and your nets used to stick to the windows. And then you've got moss underneath your windows where the damp used to come in, and it all used to go black.
When it rains, we're walking through pools of water to get in. There's no drainage at all to shift the water away from the door.
Oh, no, not again.
It was more than a problem of construction. Far from the dream of village life, it had become isolated urban living.
The family structure in the slums, where you had mom and the daughter was living around the corner raising her children, and the son was living around another corner, they had their own built-in social security system where they looked after mum in her old age and mum looked after the kids. So what housing managers did was take no notice of that. And they pushed mum out to this end of the city and son out of that and daughter out of that and broke the whole damn thing down. They did it in London, they did it in every city in the country.
You go out one morning, you come back and you say, I haven't seen anybody today. And then desperation starts, who am I going to see? And you don't see anybody. And then a fortnight, you've seen nobody. 3 weeks, only your front door and four walls.
So the architects adjusted their plan. Deck access blocks, streets in the sky, walkways from block to block. Still, no one listened to the tenants. It was just tinkering at the margins.
The government had no advisors on housing management up till the mid-1970s. It had hundreds of architects advising it, and it was only after the event that they realised that rented housing is about managing it as well as building it. In fact, it's about building it for a couple of years and then managing it for 60.
Vote on Thursday and vote Labour.
In 1974, after a brief spell out of office, Labour were back in power and were confronted by a state seething with discontent. Visiting mayors who ventured onto them just faced a torrent of complaint. No flags or brass bands welcomed them now.
Honest to God, when you've got kids, you do nothing. You're living in bulkman places here. And this is what they put people that always lived in decent housing into.
The 1974 reorganisation of local government had made the councils much more remote from their tenants. With no evident answers to problems from vandalism to escalating rents, most councillors just retreated to their town halls.
You could ring up sometimes to try and talk to one of the housing area officers. You'd tell them about your problem you may have with a tenant or something like that, and you wanted a bit of action taken. And then you'd ask, well, what's your name, so I can ring back. They weren't allowed to give names in those days. So if you wanted to ring back to find out the progress of your particular report, you got nowhere with it because you'd got to start to repeat it to someone else. And it became a nightmare. You were discussing it 2 or 3 times over and over again. They were in their little ivory tower, and if you reported anything, things didn't seem to happen.
Instead of council housing being something to which most people aspired, it became something from which they longed to escape. The first to go were the original model citizens.
People were moving out to go into houses, probably the first time they'd lived in proper housing. And the people that were moving into the flats, they didn't respect them quite as much as they should have done.
The estates became a microcosm of the nation's social problems. The old plan of selecting people for their housekeeping skills, employment record, and general respectability was virtually abandoned.
It's not a plan to segregate at all. I mean, that doesn't enter into the question. If a family needs rehousing, then they're rehoused as near as possible to where they want to go, irrespective of the cleanliness.
We hope that the good people round about, the nice, clean people round about, will help to uplift the sort of a substandard tenant.
Unfortunately, it was a bad apple syndrome where one used to spoil everything for everyone else.
And I could take you down there now and show you where my window's boarded up by vandals at the weekend.
But I'd rather live with 1,000 mice than live with the people who are living around here. Mm. I would. It's not safe, you go out for a night out, you're scared stiff to come up the stairs in case somebody hits you on the head. You're scared to go in the lift.
You're petrified,
they're terrible people around here, they are, honest.
Some estates were now so tough that eligible families refused to move into them. Empty flats had to be boarded up. At the same time, homelessness grew amongst those for whom the councils didn't want or didn't have to take responsibility. Squatting became endemic.
And who wants to see my new home now?
Success.
I'll give you a guided tour around the house now.
In 1977, the Labour government bowed to the inevitable and passed a law compelling the councils to find homes for the homeless.
The slum clearance programme was coming to an end, and councils were still producing the last round of big estates. They didn't have people to move into them. So they were going to have these large empty estates unless other people became eligible. And that was coupled with the squatting pressures and the racial pressures and the fact that private landlords were disappearing. People had to be housed somewhere. So it was a way of ensuring access for people who otherwise would have been excluded and were potentially homeless.
At the same time, it was a far cry from the heady days of the 50s.
I wish we could have it like we did. We used to have a Christmas tree when we first went, in the hallway. We used to have trimmings up. We used to have a collection so that we could have the trimmings on the tree. And then in the 70s, we couldn't have a Christmas tree because of the vandalism that was going on.
Nonetheless, away from the much publicised disasters, there had been real successes. Two-thirds of council tenants were living not in flats, but decent houses most people wanted. Virtually everyone in the land had running water and proper sanitation. But the councils were no longer trusted, and the mood had changed profoundly. The new Tory leader sensed what had happened. Instead of promising more money for council housing, she promised less. Instead of building more, it was time to sell them off.
Mr. and Mrs. Parker applied to buy the house because they liked it very much, but it still had a Labour council. And the Labour council turned you down, didn't they?
To Labour's dismay, it was a winning message. After Thatcher's election, over 1 million council tenants grasped the opportunity of joining the property-owning classes at a discount. Joan and George Day, by then residents of Castle Vale Estate in Birmingham, were among them. It was a cruel shock for local councils.
The Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher, said that the council was out of order. They forced the Labour Council in Birmingham to restart selling the houses again. When the surveyor came down, he valued the house at £11,000. Quite reasonable. And with what we got to pay for the mortgage only amounted to a fraction of what we was paying for rent.
the best houses were sold to their tenants. Housing associations and quangos took over responsibility for new building. Local councils were left to house the homeless and deal with the buildings no one else wanted.
We did a survey 4 years ago to look at all the problems. It was going to cost £30,000 per flat, and they didn't guarantee us a 30-year life for those. We felt that it certainly wasn't viable. It wasn't economical to do that. The only thing that we could do with these blocks was to demolish them. When you think, really, that they've only been up 28 years, it is really a tragedy that we spent all that money putting those blocks up and they've now got to come down. In fact, the debt charges on those blocks to be put up have still not been paid for. So when it's a green open space, we'll still be paying debt charges for 8 blocks of flats that are no longer there.
But the people who created the dream did change the face of Britain. The slums have gone. The standard of living for most has immeasurably improved. It was human nature that failed the planners as much as the other way around.
They were motivated by some collective sense of doing better for a country that had suffered incredible hardship during the war, and they really believed that they knew what the solutions were. I suppose of all the things that I don't believe that there are perfect solutions that can just be superimposed on existing communities. And if there's any lesson from the dream, it's that we didn't listen to the people.
Chestnut House, Beech Court, Elm Tree Tower. Those naive and optimistic names designed to conjure up the original ideal are parking spaces to travellers now. Soon the demolition men will move in to take away the last vestige of some planner's dream.
We did clear the slums. We got the slum clearance. And we were never educated to handle it. We were never trained to handle it. All we got was our enthusiasm and our desire to do the right thing. And somewhere along the way, we made mistakes. But by and large, I'm bound to say, we got something to be proud of. We housed a lot of people.
There is one small courtyard in Birmingham that has escaped demolition. Up the entry to Court 15 lie the last 4 back-to-backs in the city. The council is planning to preserve them, just as they are, as a reminder of how things were for 4 million people, and why so many tried so hard to make things better.
Next Sunday's programme examines some of the landmarks in the history of the education system. That's at 8:10 here on BBC Two.